One of the most important tests you need to get on a soil test is base saturation. That is just a ratio of 5 different nutrients to each other, and the one we want to focus on today is base saturation potassium.
You know, it makes so much sense when you're looking at soil tests that there's more to the story, right? So when you see parts per million and you say, well, how come in this field parts per million is high? And how come in this field the same number of parts per million is rated as low? Well, there's a lot of differences out there in soils when it comes to heavier soils with more nutrient holding capacity and lighter soils and so forth. It makes sense too that the balance of those nutrients is important. When you have a high amount of potassium in a soil and a low amount of phosphorus, for example, well, it makes sense, right? You're out of balance. We need more phosphorus to build things up. And that's exactly what we're talking about with base saturation, in that we're looking at the positively charged nutrients that are attached to our negatively charged soil and looking at the ratios of those so you can start figuring out where your best return on investment is going to be adding additional nutrients to your field.
So the other things that we're looking at in ratio to potassium here are magnesium, calcium, sodium, and hydrogen. And again, we're just looking for a certain ratio of potassium. What it really amounts to is a couple of things. And I'll just take you back to even when I was in college years ago, I would hear a lot of, well, in South Dakota, there's so much potassium in the soil that farmers don't really need to add potassium. Okay, here's why that's a bunch of nonsense. First of all, most of the potassium that's in soil is in the form of a rock. Okay, rock does not break down real quickly for crop. The second reason why that's a ridiculous statement to say we don't need to add potassium is because we have so much calcium and so much magnesium in a lot of the soils in my area that we're out of balance with potassium. What we're looking for is at least 4%, if not up to 8% base saturation K. In other words, I want of those 5 nutrients, again, it's calcium, magnesium, sodium, hydrogen, potassium, I want at least 4 to 8% to be potassium. So we first started identifying this on our own farm as having potassium deficiencies when we saw parts per million as pretty decent, but our base saturation K was less than 2%, and we saw potassium deficiency in plants.
So if this base saturation concept and the concept of balancing those nutrients is new to you, and you say, wow, that's something different than what I've heard in the past, I wonder how I can tell if they're right. Well, one way that we look at it on our farm is we do plant tissue analysis throughout the growing season. So we'll pull soil samples and then in those same spots, come back and take plant tissue at various stages throughout the growing season. Often we'll do it weekly as that plant is growing. And we'll look to see, are we actually getting the potassium or any other nutrient into the plant? So where we see a low base saturation K, what our plant tissue tests have shown throughout the season is we're just not getting enough potassium into the plant. Oftentimes, we'll get enough in very early in the season, but we run out of gas within just a few weeks when that crop really starts rapidly growing.
One of the things too that we talk to people about is they say, well, I'm gonna fertilize my corn and not fertilize my beans. Look, soybeans on a per day basis need way more potassium than corn even. So I'm not saying, oh, we wanna go fertilize our beans super heavily. I'm just saying we've gotta get our soil test levels up in order for us to maximize our soybean yields. Again, soybeans need a crazy amount of potassium on a per day basis at their peak. It's a short time, but at their peak, they're gonna take more than what a really good corn crop's going to take.
So if you're looking at your soil test data and you say, wow, I am short of base saturation K, how do I build those levels up? Well, there are a lot of different ways you could add potassium to your soil, and this really comes back to knowing that balance. When it comes to, well, should I do something with my planter, or should I do something either broadcast or in a deep band or some other alternative method, then you have to look at really how many pounds of potassium you're going to need.
Where Darren's going with that is if you need a lot of pounds of potassium, you can't put that near the seed, and you're probably gonna wanna broadcast that. So let's put it this way. If you own ground over the long haul, over the next 50 years, you're probably ahead to just broadcast that potassium, but it's going to be expensive. You're going to spend money on that ground. There's no way I'm gonna do that if I'm renting ground and I need a tremendous amount of potassium. If I'm renting ground and I need a lot of K, I'm either gonna look at banding it, or I'm gonna go talk to the landlord, which we have done in a couple cases, and say, hey, your ground's really low on potassium. you know, I don't mind putting it out there, but it's going to take 10 years to extract all that from the soil. So can we maybe share in the cost or something like that? Anyway, with this potassium thing, we just really encourage you, take a look at your base saturation K test. We want to see that at least 4%, if not up to 8%, if you want really, really great yields. And yes, it may take a lot of investment on the upfront side, but it'll end up paying off long term because you'll have more potassium available to get into your plants.
One thing that we didn't mention is the differences in soil texture. So if you've got a really sandy soil and you're in a high rainfall area, well, potassium can move down through that soil, and you probably don't want to put a whole bunch of it out there thinking I might lose some. But here's the other side of that. Well, you don't have a whole lot of nutrient holding capacity, so your percentage of K is more than likely a little bit higher, or it wouldn't take very much to get it up into that optimum range. In heavy soils with lower rainfall, we don't normally worry much about potassium leaching.
Well, having the right amount of potassium on your farm is incredibly important to high yields, and so is controlling our weed of the week. We'll tell you how to stop it on your farm coming up later in the show.